So in this class we will understand the energy meter working and the various torques that are available inside an energy meter. Okay, so we will see or we will understand the energy meter working by considering this fact, right? So the driving torque, what is meant by driving torque? The torque which is used to rotate or which is used to move the aluminium disc inside an energy meter. Okay, so the torque which is used to move the aluminium disc inside the energy meter is called driving torque. Similarly, the torque which is used to oppose the movement of aluminium disc is called as the braking torque, and the aluminium disc will attain a steady state speed when the driving torque as well as the braking torques both are equal. Okay, now let us see how to derive the driving torque by understanding a preliminary concept, right? Here, in order to produce the driving torque in a induction type energy meter, we need to have two coils, two current carrying coils or two electromagnets, right? And see, this is the aluminium disc. So this is the aluminium disc, right? And if you observe, above the aluminium disc I have two electromagnets, and through the two electromagnets I am allowing I1 current through one of the electromagnet and I2 current through the second electromagnet. Because of the direction of the due to the direction of this current flowing through these two coils of the electromagnet, you will have the magnetic flux phi1 which is downwards, and phi2 which is also moving downwards, right? Now let us see how a driving torque inside an energy meter produced by considering two different coils here. So as I am allowing I1 and I2 as mains, I1 and I2 are time varying currents. What we need to understand is I1 and I2 are time varying currents or alternating currents, right? When I1 and I2 are alternating currents, the flux phi1 and phi2 will also be alternate. So now as phi1 and phi2 are alternate magnetic fields, because I1 and I2 are the alternate currents, the magnetic fields are also time varying magnetic fields, or fluxes are time varying fluxes. So these time varying fluxes create some induced EMF, and that EMF is called as a eddy EMF, which is produced inside, which is produced on the aluminium disc. So the EMF which is induced here will will create some currents. According to Lenz's law, the currents that are produced due to these flux phi1 and phi2 are in such a way that they must produce a flux which is opposite to the actual flux. So actually the phi1 is downwards, so you must have the eddy current which is produced in such a way that in such a direction that, so this is the eddy current produced by phi1, right? Now what must be the direction of this eddy current? So the direction of this eddy current must be in such a way that it must oppose, it will create a flux which opposes phi1. So if you have the current direction like this, right, then only you will have the magnetic field which is opposite to phi1. So this current is the eddy current produced by the flux phi1. Similarly, you also have another eddy current which is produced due to the flux phi2. Is it right or not? So let us draw that eddy current. So that eddy current is like this. So this is the eddy current produced by phi2. So the brown color indicates the eddy current produced by phi1, whereas this color indicates the eddy current produced by phi2. Now, how will be this eddy current? So the direction of this eddy current is also same as IE1, because it according to Lenz's law, the current produced the current produced has a direction in such a way that it must induce an opposite flux to the actual available flux, right? Now, how the torque is produced? For example, if you see here at the point where phi 1 is passing through the aluminium disc, now if you observe, flux direction is downwards, flux phi 1 direction is downwards, is it right? And what is the current direction? IE2 is linking with phi 1. So the direction of IE2 like this. So this is the direction of IE2, which is current direction. Now you can find the direction of force if you know the field direction and current direction using Fleming's left hand rule. Okay, Fleming's left hand rule, you can find the direction of the force. Flux phi 1 direction is downwards. So keep your forefinger downwards. And the current direction is away from the paper. So keep your middle finger away from the paper, and thumb gives you the direction of force or direction of torque. Okay. So you will have the direction of force or torque like this. Is it right? Now I call this torque as TD2, because it is produced due to IE2. I am calling this as a TD2. Similarly, exactly at the position where phi 2, which is flux phi 2, is entering the aluminium disc, how is the torque or how is the force? So if you observe this as the direction of the flux, what is this flux? It is phi 2. Now it is phi 2. Now what is the direction of current? IE1 is entering towards the boat. This is IE1 direction. Now applying Fleming's left-hand rule again, keep your forefinger in the flux direction and keep your middle finger in the current direction, and thumb will give you the direction of force. So you will have the direction of force like this. Consider this as TD1. Why I am considering this as TD1? See, TD is nothing but driving torque here. So here, because of the interaction between I1 and IE1 and phi 2, there will be a torque produced, and this torque is trying to move the aluminium disc in this direction. Okay, and this torque is trying to move the aluminium disc in this direction. As both the torques are trying to move the aluminium disc, we call these two torques as driving torques. So TD1 is nothing but driving torque produced. Let me write here. What is TD1? TD1 is nothing but the driving torque produced due to the interaction of flux phi 2 and the eddy current IE1. Similarly, what is TD2? TD2 is also driving torque produced due to, it is also the driving torque produced due to the flux phi 1 and the eddy current IE2. Now the resultant torque is the difference between these two. So TD1 minus TD2 is TD. This is the deflecting torque, right? Now let us see what is TD1 and what is TD2. First of all, understand that because of time varying nature of phi 1, there will be an induced EMF, and this induced EMF is called as eddy EMF. Let us see the instantaneous value of eddy EMF. It is given by minus d phi 1 by dt. Okay, let us take the instantaneous values of fluxes. Phi 1 is equal to, I am assuming this as phi m 1 sine omega t. Similarly, I am creating some phase difference between phi 1 and phi 2. So I am considering that phi 2 is equal to phi m 2 sine omega t minus beta. Okay, I am assuming that the flux phi 2 lags flux phi 1 by some angle. I am creating some angular difference between these two fluxes, whereas this phi 1 and phi 2 are the instantaneous fluxes and these are the maximum fluxes. Now it is given by minus d by dt of what you will get here, phi m1 sine omega t. What is the differentiation of sine omega t? Cos omega t. So you will get minus phi m1 cos omega t into omega. Cos omega t into omega. Omega means 2 pi f. So let me write again. So minus phi m1 cos omega t into 2 pi f. 2 pi f. So this is the instantaneous value E1. Now from this instantaneous value, how can I find the RMS value? Let us understand this. Phi 1, which is RMS now. Okay, let us have the difference between these two. Let us know the difference between these two. If I use this symbol, it is nothing but instantaneous flux. Instantaneous flux. And if I use this symbol, it is nothing but RMS flux. RMS flux, which is given by phi m by root 2. We know this already for a sinusoidal signal. Now how can I write now E1 can be written as, actually I am writing it again, minus phi m1 cos omega t 2 pi f. So minus phi m1 cos omega t 2 pi f. Okay, so if I want to get RMS value, I can divide everything with root 2. So it will become RMS value of E1, and it is equal to minus phi m1 by root 2. So it is minus phi 1 and 2 pi f into cos omega t. Okay, now 2 pi and cos omega t both are constants, and so I can write E1. Cos omega t can be written as sine 90 minus omega t, or sine omega t minus 90. Let me write again like this. So E1 is equal to phi 1 into 2 pi f sine omega t minus 90. If you consider here, flux is sine omega t and induced EMF is sine omega t minus 90. Okay, so it indicates that E1 lags phi 1 by 90 degrees. Okay, E1 lags phi 1 by 90 degrees. In addition to that, by considering all these as constant except phi 1 and F, so I can write E1 as proportional to phi 1 into F. Now, what is the relation between the eddy current and the eddy EMF? What is this? This is called as eddy EMF produced due to phi 1. Phi 1 is a time varying flux, right? And because of this time varying flux, there will be an EMF induced in the aluminium disc, and we call this EMF as eddy EMF, and this eddy EMF is proportional to phi 1 into F. Consider this relation. Now, what is the relation between eddy current and eddy EMF? Eddy current is the ratio of eddy EMF by impedance of eddy current path. Z here is nothing but impedance of eddy current path. Impedance of eddy current path. Okay, this is the impedance of the eddy current path. What is meant by this? See this one. So the impedance offered by this aluminium disc for this eddy current path, it may be I1 and IE2. So it is Z. Now by substituting I1, which is proportional to phi1 into f, I can write it as IE1 is proportional to phi1 into f by z. Okay. Similarly, I can also write, so consider this equation, and similarly, by using the same analysis, we can also write IE2, which is second eddy current produced due to induced eddy EMF E2 is proportional to phi2 F by Z. Okay. Now, based upon this relation, or based upon this relation, let me draw the phasor diagram first. So let me change the color. So I am assuming that one current, one flux, I am considering this as flux phi1, and considering another flux which is phi2, having some angular difference between them. What is this angle? It is beta, right? Why it is beta? See here, phi1 is having sin omega t, and phi2 is having sin omega t minus beta. So the phase difference between phi1 and phi2 is beta, right? Now, how is E1 and E2? I have not written E2 here. Let me write E2 here by changing the ink. So E2 is nothing but, eddy EMF produced due to phi2. Now, what is the phasor relation between E2 and phi2? E2 lags phi2 again by 90 degrees. Okay. And in addition to that, I am also assuming that path, eddy current path, has some impedance, it indicates that the current lags, means eddy current lags the eddy EMF by some voltage. Okay. Let us assume that the current IE1, which is eddy current IE1, lags E1 by some angle alpha. Similarly, IE2 lags E2 again by some angle alpha. Okay. So this is the angular difference between the eddy currents and eddy voltages or eddy EMFs, and 90 degrees is the angular difference between the eddy EMF and the fluxes. Now, if it is phi1 and phi2, how will be E1? E1 is exactly perpendicular to phi1 like this and lags phi1, so it is 90 degrees. Similarly, how is E2? E2 also perpendicular to phi2. So this is E2 and lags by 90 degrees. Now, what about IE1? IE1 lags E1 by some angle. What is this angle? Consider this angle as alpha. And similarly, IE2 also lags E2 by some angle alpha. Okay. Now, let us find the torque, driving torque 1 is due to which two quantities? I have written the driving torque 1, TD1, is produced due to the interaction between the flux phi2 and eddy current IE1. Is it right? So now it depends upon, so TD1 is proportional to flux phi2 and current IE1 cos of angle between phi2 and IE1. Okay. Cos of the angle between phi2 and IE1. Now, what is the angle between phi2 and IE1? From the phasor diagram, this is phi2. This is phi2 and this is IE1. Phi2 is this one and this is IE1. How can you find this angle? if you observe, the angle between phi 1 and E 1 is total 90 degrees. And total 90 degrees. And the angle between phi 1 and I E 1 is 90 degrees plus alpha. And if you subtract that angle from this angle, this angle, what is this angle? So this total angle is, what is this total angle? This total angle is 90 plus alpha, is it right? 90 plus alpha, and from that 90 plus alpha subtract beta, you will get this angle, is it right? So this angle is 90 plus alpha minus beta, 90 plus alpha minus beta. So let me write TD1 again. So the driving torque TD1 is proportional to, what is the flux phi 2? Phi 2 here, I am writing phi 2 as it is. And what is IE1? IE1 is proportional to again phi 1 F by Z. So phi 1 F by Z cos of the angle between phi 2 and IE1 is 90 plus alpha minus beta. Similarly, what is TD2? TD2 is proportional to, okay, what is the flux? Flux is phi 1 and current is IE2 cos of angle between phi 1 and IE2. Phi 1 and IE2. Okay, so consider this equation as the first equation. Do I have given any equation number? No. So consider this equation as the first equation. Similarly, TD2 is proportional to phi 1. What is IE2? IE2 is proportional to phi 2 F by Z. So it is phi 1 phi 2 F by Z cos of, what is the angle between phi 1 and IE2? Phi 1 is this one, IE2 is this one, extremely opposite. Now if you observe, what is the angle between phi 1 and E1? Phi 1 and E1 is 90 degrees, is it right? Or let me do like this. This angle is beta, and the angle between phi 2 and I2 is 90 and alpha. So the angle between phi 1 and IE2 is the summation of alpha and this angle. What is this angle? This angle is 90 degrees because phi 2 and E2. So this angle is 90 degrees and this is alpha and this is another angle which is beta. So adding all these angles, you will get 90 plus alpha plus beta. 90 plus alpha plus beta. Consider this equation as second equation. Now the resultant driving torque is the difference between these two torques. So TD is proportional to TD1 minus, not TD proportional to, let me write it as equal to. So TD equal to TD1 minus TD2. Now let me change the ink color. Let me take this. Now TD equal to TD2 minus TD2, TD1 minus TD2. Now TD is proportional to, see here, in both the equations, first and second equations, phi 1 phi 2 F by Z is common, so I can take it out. So phi 1 phi 2 F by Z I am taking as common, and here you have cos 90 plus alpha plus beta. Here you have cos 90 plus alpha minus beta. Okay. So finally what you will obtain is cos 90 plus alpha plus beta minus cos 90 plus alpha minus beta. Okay. Now considering 90 plus alpha angle as A and considering beta as B, it is like cos of A plus B. Cos of A plus B is cos A cos B minus sin A sin B. Now if you write, if you expand this, it will be like this. Cos 90 plus alpha into cos beta cos A cos B minus sine 90 plus alpha into sine beta. Now, for this, what you will get? It is with negative sign. So, minus of, and it is like cos of A minus B. Cos of A minus B is cos A cos B plus sin A sin B. So, cos 90 plus alpha into cos beta plus sin 90 plus alpha into sin beta. Into sin beta. This is the difference between these two. If you evaluate or if you expand each and every term, you will get this. So, deflecting torque now is proportional to phi 1 phi 2 f by z, this entire thing. Now, it is negative sign. So, these two terms are same. First and third terms are same, but with opposite polarity. So, I can cancel them. I can cancel them. Is it right? Next. Next term, if you add both the terms, you will get minus 2. I made a mistake here, small mistake, I think so. Let me see what is the mistake I have done. Okay, here it is 90 plus alpha minus beta. So here you will get negative sign, minus sign. Okay, so here you will get negative sign, here you will get positive sign. So it is negative and it is positive. Now if it is negative, you will get plus here and here you will get minus here. Now this is negative. So this is and this one both get cancelled, both are of opposite polarity and minus of minus will get plus. So, you will get 2 times, so proportional to 2 phi 1 phi 2 f by z into sine 90 plus alpha is cos alpha, positive cos alpha and sine beta. As 2 is also constant, TD can be written as proportional to phi 1 phi 2 f by z cos alpha sin beta. This is the driving torque, resultant driving torque produced in the aluminium disc. This is the resultant driving torque produced in the aluminium disc. When you excite these two electromagnets with some phase difference of beta and in the same direction, creating the fluxes in the same direction, you will get the torque like this. Now, coming to our energy meter. So, energy meter also has two coil sets like this. Is it right? So, this is one coil which we call as the shunt or pressure coil. Okay. And you will have the energy meter construction like this. So between the shunt coil and the series coil, or between the pressure coil and current coil, we call them as pressure coil and current coil, you will have a aluminium disc. As we have seen the front view of energy meter, I am just drawing it like a rectangular plate, but actually it is a aluminium disc of a circular shape. Now what actually we do is, here also we provide the winding to one of the electromagnet, right? So this is the supply voltage V, this is the supply voltage V, and the current flowing through this winding, we call this as a pressure coil current. And I also have one more coil arrangement like this. So actually for these two current coils, we call this as current coil because it carries the current through the load. And we call this as pressure coil because it is directly connected parallel to the supply. right? Now one end of the current coil is connected to the supply and another end of the current coil is connected to the load, okay, and it is directly connected like this, right? Now if you observe the current flowing through this coil, I am assuming as a series current IS, and the current flowing through this coil I am assuming as a pressure current IP. Now what happens, see here, I am having a magnetic flux according to the direction of current. You will have the magnetic flux direction varying. Now I am assuming that if I am allowing the current like this through this pressure coil winding, you will have one magnetic flux which is created in upward direction. This is flux produced by pressure coil. Similarly, if we allow the current like this through the both current coils, but here the current is getting reversed, right? Now what is the flux here? So the flux which will be like this here, I am calling this as series flux. So series flux here is upwards and the series flux here is downwards, okay? Now observe how the driving torque here, we call this torque as driving torque on the aluminium disc, how it is produced, right? Now considering this as the aluminium disc inside the energy meter. Now energy meter has two coils basically, one is the pressure coil and another one is the series current coil. The current flowing through the current coil I am assuming as IS, and the current flowing through pressure coil I am assuming as IP. And these two currents, as they are alternating currents, they create some alternating flux. One is 5S and another one is 5P. Now if you observe, so this is the flux IP which is in upward direction. So this is the flux IP which is in upward direction. And you also have another flux which is in upward direction here. So this is the flux direction, phi s, and this is the flux direction, phi s, which is downwards here. Okay, here phi s at the left side is in upward direction, phi s at the right side is downward direction, and phi p is at the upward direction, right? Now what happens, because of this flux phi p, there will be a induced current or eddy current which is produced, and that eddy current links both the fluxes, right? So let us try that. So the eddy current produced by the flux phi p will be like this. Is it right or not? Now what is the direction of this eddy current? The direction of this eddy current must be in such a way that it must oppose phi p, which is the pressure coil current. So now this current I am assuming, see, according to Lenz's law, it must be in this direction. It must be in this direction, because if we have the eddy current in this direction, it will create some magnetic flux which opposes phi p according to Lenz's law. So this is IEP. This is IEP. Now, what is the torque produced here because of IEP and phi s? What is the IEP direction towards the paper or towards the board? Here at this position, it is towards the paper. And what is the flux direction? Flux direction is upwards. Flux direction is upwards. Okay, let me write like this. Flux phi s is upwards. Current IEP is towards the paper. Now, how will be the force direction? According to Fleming's left hand rule, if we keep your forefinger in the direction of flux and middle finger in the direction of current, and the movement of the driving torque or the force will be in this direction. Okay, so this is the force direction. Similarly, here if you observe, what is the direction of the flux? Direction of the flux is downwards. So flux phi s is downwards. And what is the direction of current? It is away from the paper at this position, especially it is away from the paper. It is like away from the paper. So it is IEP. Now, how is the force? So keep your thumb in the direction of flux and keep your forefinger in the direction of flux and keep your middle finger in the direction of current. The thumb gives you the direction of force. So this is the direction of the force. So finally, the force created by or the torque. So let me write like this. This is the direction of torque created by the fluxes phi s, the flux phi s and the eddy current IEP. Because these two forces are in the same direction, as these two forces are in the same direction, the net force is the summation of these two forces and the net torque will be in the same direction. So the torque created by phi s and IEP is like this. Okay. Similarly, for the same aluminium disc, let me take another means I am dividing the total phenomenon into two stages. Okay, so both are happening at a time, but I divided into two stages for easy understanding. Now let us give the fluxes. So you have a flux at the central limb, which is the flux produced due to the pressure coil, and you have two fluxes at the left side or left limb and right limb, and these two fluxes are phi s, this is upwards, and here the phi s is downwards. Phi s is downwards. Now because of this phi s and this phi s, how is the eddy current? That is we need to understand. How is the eddy current here? So the eddy current here will be the eddy current due to phi s will be like this and touching with phi s, phi p. Now what is the direction of this eddy current? The direction of this eddy current is like this, because it must oppose the phi s such that, so this is the eddy current IEP. Similarly, what is the eddy current due to another phi s? So like this. What is the direction of this? The direction of this is like this. So you need to have the flux, you need to have the current in this direction to oppose the fluxes, to oppose the fluxes, right? So these two currents are the two eddy currents. The direction of eddy current, I made a mistake here. So the direction is wrong. Okay. So the direction of eddy current will be like this. The direction of eddy current will be like this. And here, what is the direction of eddy current? The direction of eddy current will be like this. So the direction of eddy current will be like this, and the direction of this eddy current will be like this. So here the two eddy currents are entering, or the two eddy currents are leaving. So this is the direction of eddy current here. Okay, it is away from the paper. Let us see the current direction, IE. This is the current direction which is away from the paper. Is it right? And how is flux phi p? Flux phi p is upwards. Flux phi p is upwards. Now, what is the direction of force? So according to left hand rule, Fleming's left hand rule, keep your forefinger in the direction of flux and keep your middle finger in the direction of current, you will get the direction of force. So the direction of force is in from right to left. Okay, so the direction of the force which is created by the flux phi s and the current IEP, eddy current IEP, is from left to right, whereas the direction of the force which is created by the flux phi p and the eddy current IES. IES is nothing but the eddy current which is produced due to phi s. IEP is nothing but the eddy current which is produced due to, let us consider this as IES. Okay, I made a mistake here. Okay, now this force is in opposite direction. So how will be the torque? The torque is in this direction. So let me write here, the torque created by phi p and IES, okay, is in this direction. Now the resultant torque is the difference between these two. Okay, let me write here, resultant torque is the difference between two torques. Okay, so this is about the driving torque which is produced inside a induction type energy meter. Why it is called as induction type energy meter? So it is like a mutual induction or electromagnetic induction, because you have a time varying magnetic field. When this time varying magnetic field or flux links with the conductor, there will be an induced EMF created. Because of this induced EMF, there will be some torque. Okay, hence this instrument is called as induction type energy meter. Now let us see for induction type energy meter, for our case, or for induction type energy meter, if you see here, the current IP is proportional to the voltage I. So current IP, which is the pressure coil current, is proportional to voltage, and the flux produced in the pressure coil is proportional to IP. It is obvious. Okay, the flux which is produced in the pressure coil depends upon the current flowing through the pressure coil, and as the pressure coil is directly connected parallel to the supply, IP is proportional to V. Okay, so, and in addition to that, what is IS? IS is the current flowing through the current coil. This is the coil, which is the current coil. Now it is nothing but the load current. Here V is almost equal to VL by ignoring the errors which are caused due to connections which we have seen in our watt meter. There will be some small errors which will be created due to the connections, and we are neglecting those errors for our understanding. And now the supply voltage is same as the voltage across the load, and the current flowing through current coil. Okay, and IP is nothing but the current flowing through pressure coil. IS is nothing but the current flowing through current coil. So these two currents, one is proportional to load current and another one is proportional to voltage. Now, and what about phi s? Phi s again is proportional to IS. Phi s is proportional to IS. Now, let us change the torque expression for our case. In order to change the torque expression, I need to draw another phasor diagram. So consider this as the voltage of the supply, which is almost equal to VL, load voltage. Now, how is IL? It depends upon the phase angle of the load or power factor of the load. So I am considering this as IL, or which is also equal to IS. Now, what is the phase angle between them? It is phi. Okay, so this value depends upon the nature of the load. If it is a resistive load, phi is 0. If it is pure inductive or capacitive load, the phi is 90 degrees. Now, What is how is phi s? Phi s will be in phase with is. Phi s will be in phase with is. Similarly, I am considering another current, which is the current through pressure coil. Current through pressure coil. And how is phi p? Phi p, which is the flux produced due to the pressure coil current, is in phase with ip. And now I am assuming that the angle between the voltage and the pressure coil current is delta. Delta is the angle between voltage and pressure coil current. This is the delta. And if the angle between voltage and IL is phi, and what will be this angle? This angle will be delta minus phi. Delta minus phi. Similarly, as we know now, phi p and phi s, which are the two fluxes, how will be the induced EMF created by phi s? Induced EMF created by phi s will make an angle of 90 degrees. So this is the angle of 90 degrees with is. So the induced EMF created due to the current flowing through the current coil, I am assuming it as es. And how will be the voltage es? Voltage es is this one, and this is voltage ep. So the angle between is and es is always 90 degrees, because phi s and es is 90 degrees, and the angle between phi p and ep is also 90 degrees. Similarly, if the eddy current path has some impedance such that the eddy current, which is produced due to the series current, I am assuming it as ies. So considering this as alpha, you also have another current, which is IEP, eddy current due to eddy EMF EP, and this angle is also alpha. Okay, so this is the phasor diagram. So this phasor diagram is very, 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 very important for your competitive examinations, especially because there are a lot of problems, a lot of questions that may ask in your competitive examinations related to this phasor diagram. Okay, now let us get the deflecting torque expression again. So deflecting torque, so deflecting torque or driving torque, both are nothing but the same torques, whereas the deflecting torque is used to move the pointer, and the driving torque is used to rotate or is used to move the disc. This is the only difference. We can consider them as both as same. So this is the deflecting torque. TD is proportional to phi 1 phi 2 f by z cos alpha sin beta. So TD is proportional to phi 1 phi 2 f by z cos alpha sin beta. Right now, the deflecting the flux phi 1, consider the flux phi 1 as phi p, consider flux phi 1 as phi p. I can consider flux phi 1 as phi s. So considering flux phi 1 as phi s, and considering flux phi 2 is as pressure coil flux phi p. Now this deflecting torque expression is modified as phi 1 in place of phi 1, what I can take? Phi s in place of phi 2, what I can take? Phi p divided with z into f cos alpha into cos beta. Now phi s is actually proportional to is. Is it right or not? Phi s is actually proportional to is, and is is nothing but il. Is is nothing but il. So td is proportional to, in place of phi s substitute is, and in place of phi p what I can substitute? Ip. over Z into F cos alpha cos beta. I am just modifying this equation for our induction type energy meter. Okay, so this is the thing which I am doing right now. As IS is nothing but IL, I can replace IS with IL, and as IP is proportional to voltage V, or V is nothing but VL, so in place of TD, what we will get? In place of IS, IL, in place of IP, VL by Z into F into cos alpha cos beta. Now, what is actually beta here? If you see the previous phasor diagram, beta is nothing but the phase difference between phi 1 and phi 2, between the two fluxes, what is the phase difference? Here, if you observe, what is the phase difference between two currents or two fluxes, phi s and phi p? What is the phase difference? Delta minus phi. So, in place of beta here, we have the angle delta minus phi. Okay. Now, TD is proportional to IL VL by Z into F cos alpha, here sin beta, right? I made a mistake. Sorry for that. So here at every place you will get sin beta. So sin beta, and it is sin beta here, and it is sin beta here. Now in place of sin beta, what I can substitute? Delta minus phi. Delta minus phi. Okay. Now if you observe, what is Z? Z is nothing but impedance of eddy current path. So this impedance of eddy current path depends upon the type of material. If aluminium disc is used, the impedance is one value. If the copper disc is used, the impedance will be another value, like that. And in addition to that, what is alpha? It is a phase difference between eddy EMF and eddy currents. Okay. So phase difference between eddy EMF and eddy current. Now, for a particular instrument, the impedance of the eddy current path as well as the phase difference between eddy EMF and eddy current will be constant. And when the supply is also constant, let me write here, for a particular system and a particular supply, for a particular instrument or disc, whatever it may be, for a particular instrument and for a particular supply of 50 Hertz, for a particular supply, what is the supply actually? We use actually this for 50 Hertz frequency. So for a particular instrument and for a particular supply, Z, F and alpha, all are constants. When they all are constants, now the driving torque is proportional to, I can remove Z, F and cos alpha. It is proportional to VL, IL, sine delta minus phi. That's it. Let me erase this. Sine delta minus phi. What is delta actually? What is meant by delta? Delta minus phi is nothing but the angle between IS and IP. Phi is nothing but the power factor angle. It depends upon the load. We cannot control this. And delta, if you see here, it is the phase angle between the supply voltage and the pressure coil current or pressure coil flux. Let me write here, this is an important angle. Delta E is the angle between, what is this? This is the angle between supply voltage V, and pressure coil flux phi P, pressure coil flux phi P or pressure coil current IP. Now, let us understand if the voltage between, if the phase angle between the voltage and the pressure coil current is 90 degrees, let us see that. What will happen if the phase angle between the supply voltage, and pressure coil current, supply voltage and current through pressure coil, supply voltage is V and the current flow through pressure coil is IP. If the phase angle between supply voltage and current through pressure coil is 90 degrees, so it implies that delta value is equal to 90 degrees. When delta is equal to 90 degrees, the driving torque is actually proportional to VL IL sine delta minus phi. VL IL sine delta minus phi. If delta is equal to 90 degrees, substituting delta is equal to 90 degrees, the deflecting torque is proportional to VL IL sine 90 minus phi is cos phi. Here the driving torque or the deflecting torque now can be proportional to the power consumed by the load. What is VL IL cos phi? Power consumed by the load. This value. This is the power consumed by the load. Now the deflecting torque can be proportional to P, which is the power consumed by the load. So in order to rotate the disc based upon the amount of power that the consumer is using, we need to make sure that the phase angle between supply voltage and current to pressure coil is 90 degrees. Now, when it will happen? Let me write like this. When it will happen? It will happen when we make the pressure coil a purely inductive coil. When it will happen? If the pressure coil is purely inductive, right? In that case, if the pressure coil is purely inductive, L, then what is the phase difference between V and IP? The phase angle between V and IP will be 90 degrees because the current flowing through the pressure coil lags the voltage exactly by 90 degrees. If the pressure coil is purely inductive, if I make like this, delta will be 90 degrees. In that case, the driving torque is proportional to the power consumed by the load. But practically, delta will be somewhat less than 90 degrees. Though the pressure coil has more number of turns, the number of turns of the pressure coil is more, so that the inductance is more, but not the resistance is zero. It is a less value or is a lesser value compared to inductance, or very much lesser when compared to inductance, but not zero, right? When resistance of this pressure coil winding is not zero, the phase angle between the supply voltage and the pressure coil current will not be 90 degrees. It will be somewhat less than 90 degrees, right? When it is somewhat less than 90 degrees, the damp, the driving torque will be like this. Okay, so it is the actual reading, or it is the actual value, or it is the actual power that we can measure with the help of this energy meter. Okay, so this is about the driving torque. So we have seen in this class that how a driving torque is produced in case of energy meter, because in order to produce the driving torque we need two current carrying coils or two electromagnets, and that there will be some resultant torque because of two fluxes and two currents, and in addition to that we also have seen how to derive the expression for how to find the relation between the driving torque and the power. Okay, in the next class we will see the braking torque, how the braking torque is produced, and we will see the equilibrium condition with which we can understand the energy meter working principle. Okay, so I hope it is clear for you up to now.